This program was paid for by Water of Life Church. From Water of Life Ministries in Plano, Texas, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is speaking through his servants to the world. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying today. Let us join Doyle Davidson and others of Water of Life, sowing the Word of God in spirit and in truth.
Hello, I'm the Lord Davis, servant and apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, ministering locally to the body of Christ in Dallas and Fort Worth, Texas, and sent by God to your house to declare unto you the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank God. 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4 tell us what the gospel is, how that Jesus Christ died for our sins, according to Scripture. He was buried. He rose again the third day, according to the Scripture. Thank God. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, sent me to heal the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to the captives, recovering the sight to the blind, set at liberty them that are bruised. Amen. The word is nothing in your heart, in your mouth, is a word of faith, which I preach. You will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. With the heart, man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. Amen. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation, everyone believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. Thank God. Amen. Therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as is written, the just shall live by his faith. Thank God. I want to welcome all of you on live stream, shortwave, Boku, or other devices to this Sunday early evening broadcast from Plano, Texas. Modern warfare. We have with us tonight one that came to my ministry 30 years ago, and a mother with faith, and she has some faith. Thank God. And over the last 2 or 3 years, God has brought her forth ministering in song, Jerry Brown doing God on the Mount. Then, Kathy D will be preaching, and you have to stay tuned to find out what else.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But then things change and you're down in the valley. Don't lose faith, for you're never alone. God on the mountain, He's still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. And the God of the good times, He's still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God in. Talk of faith when you're up on the mountain and your talk comes so easy. Life's at its best, but it's down in the valley of trials and temptation. That's when your faith is really put to the test. the God on the mountain, He's still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. And the God of the good times, He's still God in the bad times. The God of the day, yes, you talk of faith when you're up on your mountain, and your talk comes so easy. Life's at its best, but it's down in that valley of trials and temptation. That's when your faith is really put to the test. For the God on the mountain, He's still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. And the God of the good times, He's still God in the bad times. The God
Terry. Let's begin with prayer. Father, I thank you. My heavenly Father, I thank you. I thank you. Father, I thank you. I thank you. Let the power of my Lord be great. Father, let the power of my Lord be great, and grant your people repentance. Open our eyes that we can see. Open our ears that we can hear, and open our hearts like you did for Lydia, that we can attend unto the things which are spoken. Turn us from darkness to light, from the power of Satan unto God. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you will turn with me to Mark 5, we're going to take a look at some people that got what they needed from Jesus and how they got it. Mark 5, verse 1. And it came over, the disciples and Jesus, to the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. This man was obviously mentally possessed by the devil. It says, a man with an unclean spirit who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains. I have worked with children like this, and it's a very sad situation. Because that he had been bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. Now look what happens next. But when he saw Jesus afar off, when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran. He didn't run away from Jesus. He ran to Jesus. This man was obviously possessed, and his psyche was under attack by the devil. And what's he do? He doesn't run away from Jesus. He runs to Jesus, runs to him and worships him and cried with a loud voice and said, "What have I to do with thee, Jesus, Son of the Most High God?" How did he know that? How did he know that? He said, "I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. For Jesus said unto him, Come out of the man, that unclean spirit." The man ran to Jesus and worshiped him. Greatly afflicted, ran to Jesus and worshiped him. Jesus said, "Come out of the man, that unclean spirit." And he said, "What is thy name?" And the man answered, saying, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And he besought him much that he would not send them out into the country. Now there was there in the mountains a great herd of swine feeding. And all the devils besought him, saying, "Send us into the swine that we may enter into them." And forthwith Jesus gave them leave. And the unclean spirits went out, entered into the swine. This is a herd of 3,000. And the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea. Oh, 2,000, I'm sorry. For there are about 2,000 pigs. The spirits in that man made 2,000 pigs commit suicide. You don't think the spirit of a man can handle some? And it said, and they were choked in the sea. And they that fed the swine fled and told it in the city and in the country. And they went out to see what was done. And they come to Jesus, and they see him that was possessed with the devil, that ran to Jesus and worshiped him. Ran to Jesus and worshiped him. And had the legion sitting and clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. This is what happened to a man that ran to Jesus and worshiped him. Now, let's go down to verse 22. And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. Jesus had crossed the lake, came back. There cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw Jesus, he cometh. He must have known Jesus was showing up. He comes. And then when he sees Jesus, when he saw him, he fell at his feet and besought him greatly, saying, "My little daughter," not me, "my little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her that she may be healed and she shall live." He knew he was coming. He cometh to Jesus. He besought him greatly, down on his face. And Jesus went with him. And much people followed him and thronged him. And I want us to skip down to 35. While he yet spoke, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house, certain, Jairus' house, said, "Thy daughter's dead. Why troublest thou the master any further?" She's already dead. And what does he say? He said to her, as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, that she was dead, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, "Be not afraid. Only believe. Only believe." He didn't say it's too late. He didn't say, "Well, we got this too late." No. He said, "Just believe. Just believe. Just believe. Don't be afraid. Just believe." And when he suffered no man to follow him, save Peter and James and John, the brother of James, and he cometh to the house of the ruler, the synagogue's, Jairus' house, and he sees the tumult, and them that wept and wailed greatly. And when he came in, he said to them, "Why make you this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth." And they laughed him to scorn. But when he put them out, he taketh the father and the mother of the damsel and them that were with him, entering into where the damsel was lying, the dead daughter. And he took the damsel by the hand and said unto her, "Talitha kumai," which is being interpreted, "Damsel, I say unto thee, arise." He's talking to a dead girl. He said, "Damsel, I say unto thee, arise." And straightway the damsel arose and walked. For she was aged of 12 years, and they were astonished with a great astonishment. And he charged them straightly that no man should know it, and commanded something be given her to eat. Now remember, He knew Jesus was there. He cometh to Jesus. He comes to Jesus. And then he falls down before him and besought him, asks him, please come and help me. Now let's go back to verse 25. The woman, and a certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years and had suffered many things of many physicians and had spent all that she had and was nothing better but rather drew worse. When she heard of Jesus, she hadn't seen him, she heard about him. When she heard about Jesus, it says, when she heard of Jesus, came in the press where he was behind and touched his garment, she pushed herself through the crowd. And she said, if I may but touch his clothes, I'll be whole. That's how she heard about Jesus. Somebody must have told her, you just get a hold of his clothes and you're going to be healed. That's what she believed. And she said, and straightway, the fountain of her blood dried up. She didn't even talk to Jesus. She didn't even ask him. She didn't worship him. She said, I got to get to the clothes. If I can just touch him, I heard about him. If I can just touch him, I'm going to be whole. And straightway, the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue, that power had gone out of him, turned him about in all the press and said, who touched my clothes? Can you imagine Jesus turning around? All right, who touched my clothes? And the disciple said unto him, thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and thou sayest, who touched me? Everybody's got their hands on you, and you're saying, who touched me? And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. He knew who did it. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came, fell down before him, and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, daughter, thy faith has made thee whole. I want you to notice something here. It wasn't touching the clothes. He didn't say, touching my clothes made you whole, did he? It wasn't touching the clothes. Everybody was touching his clothes. What made her healed? Her faith. Her faith. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. Now, notice everybody here in this chapter that asked, that pressed in, got what they wanted. Turn with me to Matthew 7. Verse 7. It says, ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. Do you know that's a promise? Do you know that ask, and it shall be given. Seek, and you'll find. Knock, and the door will be open. Do you know that is a promise? Do you know that all the promises of God are yes and amen? This is a promise. A promise. You know, some of the translations I've read said, ask and keep on asking. Seek and keep on seeking. Knock and keep on knocking till you get your answer. Turn with me to Luke 18. I've heard some say, oh, you just ask once and you never ask again. Yeah, well, if you're sure, if you know, I've had the Spirit of God come on me and I know for sure I speak out and it's done. But there are times I'm not so sure. And you know what you got to do? You got to bombard the situation. I mean bombard. Chapter 18, Matthew, verse 1. And he spoke a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. This goes right along with ask and you shall receive. There was in a city a judge which feared not God nor regarded man. There was a widow in that city, and she came to him saying, avenge me of mine adversary. And he would not for a while. But afterward he said within himself, though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. Now, then the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said. He said, pay attention to what this man said. He said, though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubleth me, she's hounding me day and night. She won't leave me alone. I'm going to avenge her because she's wearing me out. You know, when I lived in Frisco, I had a little gray cat, delicate little thing. My last name was Small. Her name was Awfully Small. So Awfully, quiet little, delicate little cat, meek little thing, unless she wanted something. She would hound you, follow you through the house, go wherever you went, and she would meow after you. I mean, I remember one day I was in my bedroom trying to get laundry separated, and she was at my feet. Apparently, she thought that her food bowl was empty, and it needed filled. So she came into the bedroom, and she sat at my feet, meow, 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 meow. I said, never, you know, leave me alone. I got to get this laundry separated. Meow, 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 meow. I go into the living room. I'm doing something there. She's at my feet, rubbing me. Meow, 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 meow. Meow, 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 meow. I go into the kitchen. I'm trying to get the dishes in the dishwasher. Meow, 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 meow. Meow, 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 meow. I mean, she's a little gray thing, real cute, but boy, does she have a mouth. Meow, 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 meow. And I said, all right, I will feed you just so you shut up. Immediately, the Spirit of God spoke to me. And he said, I wish you'd pray like that cat acted. I got the hint. I got the hint. Let's go to Romans 8. Why? Why does this happen? Why does that promise work? Ask and you shall receive. Seek and you'll find. Knock and the door will be open. Why does it work? There's an answer to that. Romans 8:32. What shall we say then to these things? Let's go 31. What shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all. Delivered his son up for us all. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? If you are going to the Father and asking for forgiveness, you think you're going to get it? Yes, because Jesus bore your sin. If you're going to the Father and you're asking for prosperity, for that job you need, you think you're going to get it? Yes. If you ask, you're going to get it. Why? Because Jesus did that for you on the cross. He became poor that you might be rich. He bought that for you with his own body. So if you ask for it, you're going to get it. But you got to ask. And you got to keep asking till you get it. If you need healed, Jesus bore all your sicknesses and diseases on his own body. He bought it for you on the cross, your healing, by his stripes. You were healed. So if you ask for that healing, are you going to get it? Yes. If you ask and you keep on asking until you get it. You know, I was in a situation in 08 in Frisco. And I mean, I was in a real mess. I mean, a real mess. And I couldn't even see a way out of the mess. I walked through the living room one day and I just saw what was going on, and I said, you know what? I'm going down in flames, and I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. And a little bit later, I sat down, and I was reading some Smith Wigglesworth that God directed me to read. And I was reading about a little girl that was 12 years old that had tuberculosis. And they asked Smith to come pray for her. Smith got there late at night. It was about 11 o'clock. He sent everybody to bed, and he went in with the child alone in her bedroom. He prayed from 11 o'clock to 3 o'clock in the morning. Do we have that much guts? No. 3 o'clock in the morning, he looks at the girl, and she dies. She dies. He said, I didn't come here for a dead child. The devil said, you've done it now. She died in your hands. And Smith said, God didn't send me here to kill a child. And he went, he said, I love how he says it. He said, I changed strength. Thank God. I changed strength. Thank God. And he continued to pray. And when he continued to pray, he looked to his right, and out the window was the face of Jesus looking in. The face of Jesus. And Jesus looked at Smith. And then Smith described him as a million rays of light looking at him. And he turned around and Jesus stopped looking at Smith and looked at the little girl, just looked at her. And the color came back in her face. And she started breathing. She turned over and she fell asleep. She was alive and healed. And when I was reading that, I saw in the spirit that face in that window. And I was considering all the mess I was in. I mean, oh, what a mess. What a mess. I was dying. And I saw that face in the spirit, and I said, I am not going to leave you alone until you do something for me, because there is no other answer. There is no other answer. For 3 weeks, every time I thought about it, I said, I'm looking at you, and I will not let you go until you do something for me. I was asking, just like those people in Mark 5, day and night asking. You know, Daniel had to wait 21 days for his answer. That's about how long I had to wait. And God said he sent the answer as soon as Daniel prayed, but there was war in the heavenlies. I didn't care what was in the heavenlies. I didn't care what was on earth. I needed that man to help me. And I kept praying, I will not let you go until you help me. I remember one day I walked into Doyle's office. He met me out in the hall, and I said, this is what I'm praying. He didn't even know what situation I was in. I said, but I've got Jesus. I've got him. I've got his attention, and I'm not going to let him go until I get some help. And you know what? On November 29th, Jesus showed up. Jesus showed up, and I got out of my mess. Ask. And keep on asking, wear God out. That's what Jesus said about the unjust judge. Wear him out until you get what you want. And you know what God will say when you wear him out and you get what you want? Your faith got you what you need. We are now going to have the My Girls, a recording of them singing Blessed Assurance. You need something? Start asking while this song's playing. And after them, we're going to have the Water of Life Quartet with Just a Little Talk with Jesus.
Jesus is mine, though I decline to. once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in. And then a little light from heaven filled my soul. It bathed my heart in love and wrote my name above. And just a little talk with Jesus made me whole.
Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him all about our trouble.
Listen to in the 1930s, late 30s, and 40s, and I still love them, and I can play the guitar. Hallelujah. Well, I grew up in church where they talked about Moses, talked about Daniel, talked about Isaiah, talked about Elijah. Talked about Elisha. Talked about Jesus. Talked more about Jesus than anyone else. Oh, they had to get Moses in. But when I got the charismatic movement, 1970, I was 37 years old, obeying God, doing what God told me. I heard verse of Kenneth Hagin, and I heard Warren Roberts, heard Derek Prince, heard of Kenneth Copeland, John Osteen, and Ben Marcello, Billy Graham. Thank God. I listened to all of, oh, Catherine Kuhlman. Thank God. Heard about a ball. I wanted to hear them. I want to hear what they have to say. Is this you?
Yes.
Thank you. I don't want to lose you. Amen. And I want to hear what they have to say. Heard Bob Bumper, Charles Simpson, Don Bashy. Thank God. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, what was his name? Dr. Criswell. Glory. Amen. Thank God. Listen to all. See what they had to say. One day, I heard a man talk about the spirit of Elijah. The spirit of Elijah. Charismatic. Spirit of Elijah. The spirit of Elijah. The spirit of Elijah. I listen. I do. The Bible. Elijah was anointed. Elisha received a double portion. Abraham was a prophet. Isaiah, David, Ezekiel, Nehemiah, thank God. And I read in the Bible, the spirit of the prophets was the spirit of Jesus Christ. Oh, yeah. That was the spirit in them. The spirit of Jesus Christ. But one day, Jesus Christ came. Born of a virgin. Born of a virgin. Made. That's a woman. Made under the law. Came to redeem us under the law. And Jesus came. He talked about Jeremiah. He referred to him as Jeremy. He talked about Elijah. He called him Elias. So the Bible said. Elisha, you talk about him. Talk about Isaiah. Call him Isaiah. Or something like that. And he talks about Daniel. And I knew all this. I grew up reading the Bible. I never heard anybody talk about the spirit of Elijah. Heard him talk about the spirit of Christ. Heard him talk about the Holy Spirit. Thank God. I never heard anybody talk about the spirit of Elijah. And now I'm sitting among a bunch of preachers and they say, where are all the Elijahs? Where are all the Elijahs? I've had a woman who came to me. She came to my office and she had spirit of Elijah ministry. And she'd tell people, if I want to know what's going on, I go talk to Doyle Davidson. You there?
Right here.
Yeah, I remember you. I remembered all of you. Spirit of Elijah. So, today, I do, this afternoon, and I was to address this lying devil in the body of Christ. Not everyone likes me, especially tonight. Is this Mr. Hurtado?
Yes, yes, sir.
Well, thank you. Amen. No, this spirit is wicked. It's witchcraft. It's not God. Now, it's true. If you believe the Bible, I do, that some person died and was put in a grave where Elisha was and his bones had the anointing on it and raised a guy from the dead. Well, so what? Hallelujah. God did what he wants to. Amen. But I studied about Elijah. I studied about Elisha. I studied about Ahab. I studied about Jezebel. I studied about the witch and all of her whoredoms. Yeah, Jezebel was a whore and walked in witchcraft. Well, read it yourself. Like God, walk in witchcraft and committed whoredoms. Would you turn 2 Kings 9, 22 or somewhere, KD, and see how far I am out of the ballpark?
It says, and it came to pass when Joram saw Jehu that he said, is it peace, Jehu? And he answered, what peace? So long as the whoredoms of thy mother Jezebel and her witchcrafts are so many.
Jezebel, that's all kinds of perverse sexual activities. Look it up. Yeah, that was Jezebel. No, because you walk in all kinds of whoredoms, does it make you a Jezebel? And Jezebel and all her whoredoms and her witchcrafts, she walked in witchcraft. Amen. Hallelujah. And there was no peace. No peace. Thank God. No peace. Thank God. No peace. Thank God. Thank God. So I knew about Jezebel, her whoredoms, and her witchcraft. Why? Well, I'm a student of the Bible. Oh, yes. I asked Derek French once. That was early 1971, about studying the Bible. He said, well, I've been to university. I thought, well, I bet I got more hours to university than you do, and I don't give a blank if you've been to Cambridge. That day, I confronted that spirit of arrogance with Derek Friends. Amen. I don't care what university you went to. I don't care how many hours you have. I don't care how many degrees you have. Guess what? I've been with Jesus and Jehovah. Yeah. So, the spirit of Elijah is a devil lion, and the charismatic movement is full of this lion spirit, and it's witchcraft. So, tonight I get to confront it. Confront it. Actually, I used to teach, still do, that Elijah killed all the false prophets. Those of you that have ever heard me talk and remember anything, if you're not too drunk on evil spirits, remember what I said. I said, Elijah, with the power of his anointing, and all of the false Baal prophets killed. But Jesus, with his anointing, overcame all the false prophets and forgave them. And they killed him. Is that right? Yeah. He said, beware of false prophets. Beware of false prophets, because they like the praise of perfect, because men spoke well of them. Yeah, men speaks well of false prophets. Hallelujah. Amen. So, I was really in a war, which I always am. When I got here, my God, I thought Satan had 300 or 400 demons after me. Really made me scared. I came out here, had a seat, and well, I talked, then had a seat, and it was hard to talk because the devils hate me. They hate you, but you don't even care. Amen. You don't even care. Thank you. Amen. So I just said, well, I'll just sit out here and thank God. I will thank God. And did you know Thanksgiving, the grace of God abounds? Thank God. So I just kept thanking God. Then KD talks about her cat. Wonder where that cat got that spirit. Glory. Well, don't get upset. There's the Spirit of God in your cat. So, this afternoon, wrestling with this thing for an hour and a half, God spoke to me. Psalm 68. Amen. Amen. No, there's no spirit of Elijah. God, Lord. Thank God. Where you at?
Right here.
Let's read it.
Verse 18. Thou hast ascended on high. Thou hast led captivity captive. Thou hast received gifts for men, yea, for the rebellious also, that the Lord God might dwell among them.
Thank you. Charismatic movement. Charismatics. Oh, mentioned them this morning. Might as well hit a home run with them tonight, because I know every one of you love me. Well, you have to. God, this is talking about Jesus. When he led captivity captive, he gave gifts unto men. Is that right?
That is right.
Yea, to the rebellious also. Oh my God. You see, Jesus, when he came, his ministry, it was perfect. It was innocent. No sins, no nothing. I'd never sinned. Never. Well, when God called me out of my veterinary practice in 1970 and told me to obey him for 7 years, nothing but correction, 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 correction. Come out, correction. Come out, devil. Come out of me, devil. Talking to me. To the devil. And by the time my ministry began, God had straightened my crooked paths straight. You there?
Right here.
Does it not say somewhere in the Bible, all you Bible scholars have been to all the mega churches and the Bible schools and where the great theologians are and the great legal minds teach the word? Doesn't it say somewhere that God will make the crooked path straight? Oh.
Shall I find it?
Please get me out of here. I don't want to be wrong. Glory. Amen. Thank God. I do think Peter said in Acts chapter 2 something about toward ones, that's crooked ones. Look that up too. Somebody help me. I'm in trouble. Not very much.
Ecclesiastic 1:15, that which is crooked, oh, no, I'm sorry, that's wrong.
Oh.
Cannot be made straight.
Oh, no. That's what cannot be made straight. Yeah, hallelujah. What? What?
Luke
3:5. Luke 3:5 says what?
And the crooked shall be made straight.
Thank you. Well, I was crooked. Someone really crooked. God had to make me straight to walk.
Amen.
Thank you. But what did I walk among? Crooked people. Crooked. Crooked. Look and see. Untoward generation.
Okay.
Acts 2. Crooked. Crooked, crooked, crooked. Guess what? But some of them had gifts. Some of them said they had laid hands on somebody and they got well. Some said they prayed for their child and they got well. Someone prayed for their neighbor and they got well. Some said they cast devils out. They did all kinds of things. But they were rebellious. They were rebellious. But it's scriptural. It is scriptural that they could have gifts and be rebellious. They could be committing adultery, cast the devil out of somebody. I frankly heard a self-righteous preacher talk once, and he was in Missouri, from Missouri, down southwest Missouri. I think it was McDonald County. You know, that's the most righteous county in that state. And this guy was preaching, and manna fell on all the cars outside of the building. Looked like hoarfrost. Man, when this guy told me this, my religious head and mind said, wonder what spirit he was. He may have been rebellious. And God put manna on their cars. Didn't make them all righteous, did it? Their paths were still crooked, and they were still rebellious in sin, working miracles. Yeah, God would hear them. Why? He said he would. Why? How would he ever got us out had he not answered our prayers? Yeah, just because God answered you and answered your prayers, don't think that made you righteous. Righteousness is a faith upon all and the all and the all upon all that believe. Have you found that?
Yes, it's Acts
2:40.
And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation.
Would somebody look that word up and tell me if it doesn't say crooked?
It does.
It does? It doesn't?
It does.
It does. All right. I just don't want to be wrong among a crooked generation. Can't you say I love you, Lord? Can you say it and mean it? Can you? See, I don't ask people to say I love you very much. But I used to go to charismatic meetings and they'd say, turn to the right. I love you with the love of the Lord. I wonder what else it was. Turn to the left. Say, I love you with the love of the Lord. I wonder what kind of love it was. Oh, my friends, we're not walking that way. We're walking with people and straightening them out, setting them free, walking upright in the gospel, doing the will of God from the heart. No other way. And don't be deceived just because you have faith to prophesy, cast out a devil, or do other wonderful works. That doesn't mean that you are doing the right thing, but doing the will of the Father is right. God bless you. Good night.
We invite you to visit Water of Life Church at 1621 18th Street in Plano, Texas. Or for further information, call area code 972-578-8082. That's 972-578-8082. Or write Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. That's Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. This program was paid for by Water of Life Church.